Well, welcome to week number one of our series we're calling Reply All. Back at Easter, we gave you the opportunity to tell us some topics and some things that you wanted to hear about. And as I've looked through the list and put together this series, we're going to talk about things that maybe some of you suggested, but here's what I believe. Probably all of us deal with some form of what we're going to be talking about in this series. And so there's going to be a different topic every week. It's a great series to invite your friends and family to. And so I encourage you to take advantage of that as we go through the series. Today's topic is depression. Now, that's a big topic and probably more than we can cover in one message. And so there was actually several suggestions around this topic and anxiety, depression, discouragement, people wanting to hear and wanting to understand, well, you know, really, how can I get through this? So I want to tell you right up front, I'm not a doctor. I'm not a psychologist. I'm not a psychiatrist, but I am a pastor. And so I'm going to talk to you today as a pastor because I've seen some things over the course of the years in ministry and in people's lives. And you know, no matter what is going on in your life, there's things you can do to help yourself. Amen? To just kind of take it to the next level. And so I've seen lots of people struggling with anxiety, discouragement, even depression. And I have faced those things in my own life as well. And probably you have too. And so I ran across this definition as I was preparing for this message today, and I think it's a really good definition. Depression is a mood disorder characterized by anhedonia. And what that means is that's the inability to feel pleasure, whether it's good pleasure or even pain. It's just, you just don't feel anything. You're kind of numb. It's characterized by extreme sadness, poor concentration, sleep problems, loss of appetite, and feelings of guilt, helplessness, and hopelessness. You just can't see a way out. It just doesn't seem like things are going to work out on your behalf. And in fact, depression medications are taken by 1 in 6 Americans. And in fact, 1 in 9 Americans report taking medications in the last month. And so this is a very prevalent thing in our society. Unfortunately, there's been a very negative stigma around the whole mental health area in our culture, but particularly in the church. And it's not right. I want to just say it's not right. Not in this church, but at the church at large. You know, it's just not right. You know, we don't look down on people who are fighting a sickness. We don't look down on people that are fighting a disease. And so when people struggle with mental health challenges, we need to not look down on them either. We need to love them and encourage men. And so let me just say it this way. It's okay to not be okay. Amen. If you don't think you have issues, that's your issue. We all have issues, right? We all got things we're working on. And so when we see someone struggling with anxiety, discouragement, or depression, it's okay for them to tell you. And if you're struggling in those areas, I want to just say right up front, you need to tell someone. You need to get it out of your head and get it out in public. And so when you do, and not in public with everyone, but with someone. And when you do that, if you share that in a small group or wherever you're with someone you can trust, you should be met with compassion. You should be met with prayer. You should be met with encouragement. People just saying, come on, let's take another step. Let's not give up. Let's keep moving here. Amen? Now, there is something I think that's really important with any diagnosis, but particularly if you've been medically diagnosed with depression or something like that. And I want to just tell you, that is not your identity. That is not who you are. You know, we don't say to someone they're fighting cancer, people don't say to themselves, I'm cancered. We don't say that. But when we're fighting depression, we say, I'm depressed. And we own that instead of saying, I'm fighting thoughts of depression. I'm feeling discouraged. Don't own it as an identity. Own it as something you're fighting and you're going to overcome and get the victory over. Amen? Maintain a separation between who you are and what you're fighting. I think that helps us to really look at these things as what they really are. And that's true for anything that you battle. When I'm fighting sickness or something, I say it that way. I don't say I've got whatever. I say I'm fighting, and I say whatever I'm fighting. And that's just simply because I want to keep the fight on and keep that thing away from my life. Amen? Now, 30 years ago, only one in 50 Americans took pain medications. Isn't that interesting? You say, well, that's because the diagnosis is better, the treatment options are more available. But I really think there's more to it than that. And I'm going to tell you that there's some things that we just got to look at. Much of depression is actually tied to our lifestyle choices and to how we live our lives. This is a great quote from Stephen Alardi, who's author of The Depression Cure. And he says this: we were never designed for the sedentary, indoor, socially isolated, fast food laden, sleep deprived, frenzied pace of modern life. There's so many things. I mean, it'd take a whole message just to pack all those things. There's so many things that are part of our culture today that we look at as normal part of life, and they just put a weight on us we were never designed to carry. Amen? And so how we live affects our spirit, our God part. It affects our soul, our mind, our will, and our emotions, and it affects our body. And so today, part of what I want to show you before we're done is how you can do things to help in those areas. And so here's some examples of how our modern lifestyle choices have really affected and driven, I think, mental health issues. Here's one of them: cell phones and social media. I mean, it's just always available. We now have more information available at our fingertips in any moment than our previous generation could learn about in a whole year. And so there's just bombarded with everything. You know, a week ago we were talking about Midland, Odessa, and nobody's talked about it this week because Dorian was doing its thing out East Coast, right? I mean, we just go from one thing to another. So we got all this information. Here's another one: lack of identity. We don't really know who we are. We think we're what everyone else defines us as. How about this? The inability to process pain. You know, it used to be normal that there was communities. And then I grew up in one of these where people were struggling with pain. The community came together. And now it's only the big things, it seems like, where the community comes together. But for daily life, a lot of people, they're just doing it on their own. And they don't know how to process that pain. Here's a big one: peer-to-peer mentoring. Many of our generations are learning from their peers instead of from the previous generation. The Bible set it up that the older generation is supposed to teach the younger generation because they've seen some things that you haven't seen yet. Just because they can't handle your phone, they have seen some things. Just because they need your help to turn on the DVD player, I mean, or find something on your smart TV, it doesn't mean that they can't teach you some things. Amen? And then this is a big one: just a narcissistic culture. Just about us. It's about us, who we are, what we, it's just a problem. So the sad part of all of this pressure that we're not designed to take on our lives is, for many of us, this causes us to think that the world will be better off without us. We just think, you know, suicide is the answer. In fact, suicide rates have jumped 24% in recent years. All of this is not in your notes yet. I'm just warming up here and just kind of setting the stage for you. Do you know that in America, over 47,000 people a year take their life? It's so sad. It's so terrible. So you've got to understand some things in about this, and that is, suicide is a permanent, irreversible attempt to solve a temporary problem. You're deciding that it's never going to change, and you're taking an action that will affect not only your future on earth, but everybody else around you. And so here's the thing I want you to know today: you don't have to die to end your pain. You don't have to die to end your pain. You don't have to take your life to end your pain. Now, this is the thing that suicide has permeated every level of society. And one of the things that's happened in the last few years is there's actually more and more pastors that have taken their own life. Just a year or so ago, there was a young pastor who had a healthy, growing church, young family, beautiful wife and kids, and just decided, I can't handle it anymore, and he took his own life. Just sad kind of things. And so you may have heard of Pastor Rick Warren of Saddleback Church out in California. His son battled with mental health issues and depression and eventually took his own life here a few years ago. And it's just a tragic thing. It's a sad thing. And he speaks a lot on this. He's got lots of great resources on this. But here's the thing he recommends, and I want to recommend too. If you struggle with thoughts of suicide, you need to call the suicide hotline. 1-800-273-8255. You need to call that number. And that's the National Suicide Prevention Hotline. I'd encourage everybody to write it down. Because here's why. That you may have somebody that say, I'm just having these thoughts, I'm struggling, and you can have this phone number, probably put it in your phone, and say, hey, can you call them? None of us here probably are experts at diagnosing and working with someone who's at that point, but we can get them to a resource that will help them and get on the phone with them and just help them to get to that resource. Amen? So with all of that as background, let's just look at God's Word. And because I think God's Word tells us a lot. And in the Old Testament, we find a prophet by the name of Jeremiah. Everyone say Jeremiah. And he wrote a book that's really filled with passionate expressions of grief and sorrow called Lamentations. He's lamenting some things that were going on in his nation. It says in verse 17, he says, peace has been stripped away. That's what happens for some of us. We just can't get peace anymore. And I have forgotten what prosperity is. You know, you can't even, sometimes when you get these kind of thoughts and discouraged and even depressed, you can't even remember the good old days. You're just locked into what's happening right now in your life. He says, I cry out, my splendor is gone. Everything I had hoped for from the Lord is lost. I think it's interesting that he says here, everything that I hope for from God is lost. And we can get to that place in our lives that we just say, you know, God, I don't think you're going to come through. I don't think you're going to work it out in our lives anymore. What was Jeremiah doing? He was doing something they call ruminating. And ruminating is when you get fixed on a negative thing, you get fixed on a struggle, you get fixated on a lack of progress, and you just start to grind on it. Ruminating is what cows do when they chew their cud. They swallowed it and they bring it back up again and they chew it some more and they swallow it and bring it up again and chew it some more. And that's what we do many times about the negative things that have happened in our lives. It's been 20 years and 80% of your conversation is still about that thing. You're just ruminating on it all the time. You keep bringing up the hurts. You keep bringing up the pains. And what begins to happen is we create things in our mind that are actually not true. Do you know that they've proven you can make up memories? If you grind on it long enough for enough period of time, you're going to think that's what really happened. So you can take the positive or you can take the negative, and it can be a big problem. And what happens is we end up buying into the lie of the enemy about our future, believing we don't have one. He goes on to say, the thought of my suffering and homelessness is bitter beyond words. He said, I'll never forget this awful time as I grieve over my loss. Oftentimes, depression is tied to some traumatic loss in our lives. We can't get past this and we get stuck. And it's just a particularly painful thing. And we just can't seem to be moving forward beyond that. And even the great church launcher, the Apostle Paul in the New Testament, he knew what it was like to have tragic and terrible things happen to him. In 2 Corinthians 1:8, he says, we do not want you to be uninformed. And one of the reasons I'm teaching this message is God's not embarrassed by the subject, and neither are we, and we ought to be able to talk about these things. I don't want you to be uninformed, brothers and sisters, about the troubles, he said, we experienced in the province of Asia. We were under great pressure. You know, all those things that I mentioned earlier, modern life is just pressure-packed, pressure-filled. He said, far beyond our ability to endure. We all have those breaking points, right? And so what happens? So that we despaired of life itself. It's like, I just can't even go on thinking about living because this was so painful. One of my goals today is to let you know that it's okay to battle, but let's overcome depression. Let's get the victory in our lives. And there's another story in the Bible that's very insightful that we're going to pull a number of lessons from. And it's in 1 Kings 18, the prophet Elijah. God worked through him, did great things. One of the things that happened, I'm kind of jumping to the end, but he had this showdown with 450 prophets of the false god Baal, and this big showdown, he ended up killing those prophets. But basically what happened in that showdown was they had this gathering. God said, call them together. And Elijah said, okay, you false prophets, I want you to make a sacrifice to your God. And whichever God brings down fire from heaven and burns up that sacrifice, that's the true God. And they said, got it. We can do that. No problem. They built an altar. They put their sacrifice on the altar. They started running around it and doing all their incantations and all that kind of thing. And then after a while, because the day was going on, then Elijah, you know, he was having a day. I mean, you know, he was having a good day. He was mocking them. He said, well, maybe your God can't hear you. Maybe he's asleep. He even said, maybe your God went to the bathroom and he's not back yet. So, you know, kind of get him going there. And maybe he's asleep or he's away on a trip. And Elijah was just, you know, mocking them. And so they got so frenzied by this, they began cutting themselves with whips and knives, just trying to please their God and get this fire to come down from heaven. But nothing happened. So finally Elijah said, okay, let's build my altar. And he took the stones and he put the sacrifice on it and the wood and all of that. And then he said, all right, now pour water over it. Now pour water over it again. Build a trough around it. Pour water over it again. And he stood back and he prayed, and God sent fire down from heaven, and not only burned up the sacrifice, but all the wood and all the rocks and every bit of water that was in that little trench around the altar. God left no doubt. He said, I am God. But what happened right after that? What happened right after that is that Elijah had one of the lowest lows he'd ever experienced. I don't know if you've noticed that in your life, that you go through something really great and all of a sudden right away, it's like you're so discouraged and you're so even depressed that you're like, I don't even know if I'll ever live. It's not gonna, the life is terrible. And 48 hours ago, it was the best it's ever been. It's a big risk in our lives. It's a challenge. And so I want to encourage you, you need to know when you're susceptible to lows. You need to know when you're having a kind of a high. And so for many years as a pastor, I took Mondays off. That was the thing pastors did. You take Mondays off. But I was miserable because I was dissecting my message. I was trying to figure out everything that went wrong the day before. Mondays were the most discouraging day of the week. So I got wise. I don't take Mondays off. I work on Mondays. If I'm going to be thinking about it, I just will be fixing it, right? So I Fridays is my day off. I switched it up, you know. So Elijah had to learn some things, and so he had this huge win. And then look at verse 1. Now Ahab told Jezebel, chapter 19, Ahab was the king of Israel, told his wife Jezebel everything Elijah had done and how he'd killed all the prophets with the sword. So Jezebel sent a messenger to Elijah to say, may the gods deal with me, be it ever so severely, if by this time tomorrow I do not make your life like one of them. In other words, Elijah, I'm going to kill you like you killed those prophets. Look at this next verse. Elijah was afraid and ran for his life. I mean, just think about it. He's the guy who just defeated 450 prophets and one long-tongued woman. Come on. I'm not against women. Long-time women will get you, though, right? You got to be careful. He ran for his life. When he came to Beersheba in Judah, he left his servant there while he himself went a day's journey into the wilderness. That verse reveals one of the worst things you can do when you're struggling with depression is leave your friends and those that love you and those that are there to support you behind and say, I got to get by myself. That's the worst thing you can do. He says he came to a broom bush, sat down under it. This is a bad joke, but he probably felt like his life was being swept away. Anyway, that's free. He came to a broom bush. Some of you will get that one on the way home. Sat down under it, and he prayed that he might die. I've had enough, Lord, he said. Take my life. I am no better than my ancestors. I'm not any better than what was in the past. My life is making no impact here. I've done nothing of value. I don't know about you, but I've had that thought. There's been a time in my life that I actually prayed, God, I'm done. Take my life. I repented later. But you know, we all have those moments. And Elijah had one of those moments coming off a big victory. And it was a lie for him. It was a lie for me. And it's a lie for you. You don't need God to take your life. So what are some things that contribute to depression? Let me give you several. Here's the first one. Faulty thinking. Faulty thinking. I'm a pretty optimistic type person. By the way, realism is just pessimism in disguise. For those of you that say I'm a realist, right? But I half joke that I did not know depression until I became a pastor. And that's not because pastoring is the worst calling ever. It's just because I didn't understand. And I think there's some things that were true for me and maybe true for you as well. And that is when we face something we can't see our way out of or we can't change and we don't know how to change it, it gets very heavy. We feel stuck. We feel trapped. Faulty thinking is at work there. And so what I learned is that there's some choices that I can make that can contribute to taking me from discouragement to really full-on depression. And maybe these are things that you've experienced too. A number of years ago, I just had a real struggle in this area. And I could tell when I was moving from discouragement to really probably diagnosable depression. Here's what the Lord did. In that season, the Lord gave me a picture, an image. And he gave me an image of a drain. Have you ever watched your drain in the sink or the tub or something? There's a season, a part of it, where the water is kind of swirling around the drain, but then there's a moment it's going down. And we can start to have thoughts and we can start to think things in our mind. And there comes a point that we ruminate on that long enough and we fixate on that long enough. All of a sudden, we're going down the drain. And sometimes it's very difficult to get back up through the drain. Everything in life is just pushing down on you. Everything seems overwhelming. And so I learned that I might have a thought about some things, but there are some things I needed to stop ruminating and I needed to stop going down that path or I was going to be down the drain. And I would have just encouraged you to think about that. When you go down the drain, it's a darker level. It gets very dark, very, very deep. And so I realized that I had what I call thought ruts. There were just some things that I would start thinking the first thought that led me to the second thought that led me to the third thought that led me to the fourth thought. And by the fifth thought, I was in a very dark place. My point is you need to know when your point of no return is, but don't play with it. Amen. Don't say, well, it's between 3 and 4. Well, then what are you doing hanging around 3? You know, let's catch it at the beginning. And so here was my thought. I cannot believe I'm this age and facing this. What was I saying? I thought I'd be past this by now. I thought I'd be past this. I thought I'd be better. I thought things would be different by now. I've just learned I can't think of that. When that thought comes to my mind, the first thing I do now is say, well, what can I do about what I know? I can't change where I'm at if I don't start taking action about where I'm at. I got to change my thinking. Amen. And so here's what some of you may be that way. Well, I can't believe I'm single at this age. I can't believe I've been through a divorce at this age. I can't believe my kids are acting this way at this age. Wait till the next age. No, I'm just kidding. But you know what? We get that in our lives. Here's what Paul said in Philippians 4:8. And he knew something because we just read what he'd been through. And now, dear brothers and sisters, one final thing. Fix your thoughts on what is true, honorable, and right, and pure, lovely and admirable. You got to fix your thoughts on the right things. Think about things that are excellent and worthy of praise. Now, here's the key. We're doing some of these things, thinking on these things periodically. But here's the catch. Look at this. Keep putting into practice. You got to keep doing it. Keep putting it into practice. All the things you've learned and received from me, everything you heard from me and saw me doing, then the God of peace will be with you. You say, well, I thought a good thought for 30 seconds. Well, praise the Lord. What are you going to do the next 30 seconds? And the minute after that? And the 5 minutes after that? And the 30 minutes after that? You've got to take control of your faulty thinking. You've got to not buy into those lies. I had to learn. If I start on thought one, it's going to end up in the drain. I'm not even going to think about thought one. I'm going to fix my thoughts on the right thing. Here's the second thing. Isolation really contributes to thoughts of depression. That's what Elijah did. He separated himself. He got away from those that cared most about you, about him. And here's the thing. We can't trust ourselves to know what's best for us. We just can't do it. The best thing for us is often the last thing we want to do. And if you have a friend in your life, someone around you, they can help you. Here's what Ecclesiastes 4:12 says. A person standing alone can be attacked and defeated, but two can stand back to back and conquer. Three are even better, for a triple braided cord is not easily broken. What is it? What do you need? You need to get in a small group. You need to get some people around you. I'm going to just meddle with you a little bit this morning. When it comes prayer request time, you're not saying, "Well, would you pray for my great aunt, third removed that I've never met, but heard that is sick?" We'll pray for those, and we love to. But why don't you tell us something you need prayer for in your own walk? Man, I'm struggling with really faulty thinking right now in this area. It won't become gossip; it'll become prayer. And your life can begin to change. That's why it's not too late. Get in a small group. You need some friends like that who will pray for you when you're there, pray for you when they think about you, when God brings it up in their spirit. And you watch. God's going to begin to work in the middle of that situation. Amen? Here's the third thing that we do to kind of contribute to depression. We're led by feelings. Led by feelings, right? Listen, emotions fluctuate. I feel better when I'm eating dark chocolate-covered almonds. But they have never changed any circumstance in my life except what the scale says. That's the only thing. But it's just feelings, right? We got to understand, our lives cannot be led by feelings. Here's the thing. Thoughts lead, feelings follow. If you don't like your feeling, put it in reverse and think about, what was I just thinking about? And you'll find in those moments when you're not actively working on something that you'll default to some kind of self-talk, some kind of negative thing, and you'll go back into that rumination and that rut, and what you're going to have out of that is a feeling you don't want to have, and feelings lie. So you got to, if you change a thought, you can change a feeling. Change of thought, change of feeling. Here's what John 8:32 says, and you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. It does not say feelings will set you free. It does not say that truth will set you free. It says the truth you know will set you free. When you know it, not just intellectually, but when it's coming out of your heart, coming out of your mind, and you're speaking those words of life, it's going to begin to change your feelings. Here's a bonus verse, not in your notes. Hebrews 4:12 says this. And this is important because here's the thing. Where do you get the right thoughts? Go read all of what Jesus said. Go read the Bible. It comes from God's Word. It says the Word of God is alive and powerful. Young people, adults, listen. It's not a textbook. It's the life-giving Word of God. It's going to put life on the inside of you. It's alive. It's powerful. It's sharper than the sharpest two-edged sword, cutting between soul and spirit, between joint and marrow. Here's the thing. It exposes our innermost thoughts and desires. I can't figure this out. How can I figure this out? Get the Word on it. What does the Word say about it? Here's the fourth thing that gets us in trouble. Comparison. Comparison. That's what Elijah said. I'm no better than my ancestors. I can't figure this out. It's not worth it. You want to kill your joy? Start comparing yourself. For some of you, you just need to get off social media. I mean, you just need to say, I'm not even going to check it. I'll look at it once a week and see if anybody I love cares about me, and then I'll just be done with it. Amen? Or I'll get on and encourage somebody. Galatians 1:10 says, obviously, I'm not trying to win the approval of people, but of God. If pleasing people were my goal, I would not be Christ's servant. Man, we can't live for what everybody else thinks. We got to live for what God thinks. Amen? So how do we conquer depression? So verse 5, 1 Kings chapter 19 says that Elijah lay down under the bush and fell asleep. I said, all at once an angel touched him and said, get up and eat. You know what? Sometimes God just shows up during a nap. Isn't that right? Sometimes you just need to rest. You need a nap. And so you say, well, I'm depressed. I sleep all the time. Well, that will get to some other things for you. But for some of you, you're just wore out. Elijah was wore out. He just had a great spiritual battle, a great spiritual victory, a great physical traveling. He had been running for his life. All these things were going on. He needed to rest. Discouragement sometimes will get you to the place where God can actually get you to rest. Get 8 hours of sleep. Put things in the right order. You know, oftentimes on Sunday night, even on Saturday nights for me, I can struggle with thoughts. You know, like, will y'all show up tomorrow? Can I preach? Can I still preach? Will I lose it this Sunday? I mean, it's just crazy stuff, right? And we can have those thoughts. And so what do? Saturday nights, Sunday nights, rest. I spend time with Kim, with family, and I don't think any deep thoughts. I just get a good night's rest. This morning I woke up before my alarm went off. Tomorrow morning I'll probably wake up before my alarm, ready to conquer the world. Why is that? I just got a good night's sleep. Makes all the difference in the world. It says he looked around and there by his head was some bread baked over hot coals and a jar of water. He ate and drank and then lay down again. So sometimes you just need to not binge on movies. You need to take a nap. You need to sleep. The angel of the Lord came back a second time, touched him and said, get up and eat. That's my kind of day. Come on. For the journey is too much for you. Well, you can do without that. All right. So he got up and he ate and drank. Look at this. Strengthened by that food, he traveled 40 days and 40 nights until he reached Horeb, the mountain of God. There he went into a cave and spent the night. And then something amazing happened. In the cave, God appeared to him and asked him, what are you doing here, Elijah? Elijah said, well, everybody hates me. They're trying to kill me. And I'm the only prophet left, you know, serving you. And so God sent earthquake, he sent wind, he sent fire, but he wasn't in those. It wasn't until God came in a gentle whisper. In that gentle whisper was his presence. So God asked Elijah again, what are you doing here? And what Elijah did is he repeated what he'd said before. And you know what? God didn't argue with him. Here's the thing. If you're struggling with discouragement, depression, God can handle your worst stuff. You can tell him. You need to let him know. What was Elijah doing? He was stuck in self-pity, which is a contributing factor. We just get stuck thinking about how bad it is for us. And so what did God do? God gave him the instructions to anoint two different kings over two different nations and to appoint his successor. God gave him some rest and then gave him something to do. So let's lay this out in just four simple ways how we can conquer a lifestyle-related depression. Here's the first thing. Get healthy physically. He said, well, that's the problem. Do what you can. Do what you can. Amen? Some of us, we burn the candle at both ends, and all we are is a burned-out candle. There's just nothing left, nothing we can do. Elijah had a great victory, but now he needed some rest. Look at what Psalm 127:2 says. In vain you rise early and stay up late. That's why I just rise up early, but don't stay up late. See, you can try that. What do we do? Toiling for food to eat, for he grants sleep to those he loves. Man, God wants to give you a good night's rest. You know, I read something recently that eating right is 80% of getting healthy. Amen. I realized that for years I had the idea that it was exercise that got me healthy. That's why it's been a constant battle, right? So now I'm working more on the eating right. But if we'll just eat right, get our weight right, get our energy right, and take care of our bodies, it's gonna do so much for us emotionally. Amen. And even in our thought life. Amen? Pretty soon you start getting in a habit and a routine there. You're going to get up the same time every day. You're going to have more energy, more vitality. You're going to see that you can move forward. Do the exercise, but do all the rest as well. Amen? Here's the second thing. We need to pour our heart out to God. pour our heart out. God can handle it. When God heard that Elijah said, hey, I'm the only one left, people trying to kill me, God didn't argue with him. He didn't get upset at him. God can handle your frustration. God can handle your anger. Here's the thing. He can handle your disappointments better than you think he can. It doesn't blow him away. He's not moved by that. You can even tell God the lies that you're believing. You say, God, I think I'm believing this lie. He's not going to criticize you or condemn you. He's going to work in you. Here's what Matthew 11, 28 and 29 says. Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened. What's he going to do? He's not going to condemn you. He's not going to criticize you. He said, I will give you rest. And you will find rest for your souls. Soul here is the mind, the will, and the emotions. That's what gets all out of whack. And often causes us into takes us into all kinds of places we don't want to be. So in our small groups, tell somebody, hey, I'm struggling here. They're going to pray. God's going to come in. They're not going to criticize or judge. And he's going to do a work in your life. Amen? Here's the third thing you can do. Experience the power and the presence of God. Elijah experienced both. He experienced the earthquake, the wind, and the fire. God wasn't in those, but he needed to see those. He needed to be aware that God was working. And so then he had to wait because it was in the whisper that God's presence was. We need both. We do everything we can here so that every time you come into a service, we want you to experience God's power for your situation, and we also want you to experience his presence. We pray and believe God for that. Here's what Psalm 46:10 says. Be still and know that I am God. Can you be still without your cell phone, the TV, all the notifications off? The other night I was just having a moment thinking about some things, and I just went outside and just sat outside for a while because I know that being still, didn't have my phone on, just me and Jesus. His presence. That's one of the reasons I get up in the morning and walk and pray, because I just go out there and I feel God's presence. Find that place for you and get in it every day. Here's what 2 Corinthians 4:16 says. Therefore, we do not lose heart, though outwardly we're wasting away, yet inwardly, look at this, we're being renewed day by day. Not week by week, not month by month, day by day. He says, for our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. Yes, life is tough. Yes, you've been hurt. Yes, I've been hurt. Yes, we've been disappointed. Yes, there's things that don't go our way. But I'm not thinking just about this life. He goes on, he says, so we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but on what is unseen. Since what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal. Each week, there's dozens of dream teamers. You've seen many of them in the shirts today. They're around here. They're serving. They don't come and serve because their day's been perfect. Their life's perfect. They come serve because they know that their problems are temporary, but you are eternal. They serve for you and to make a difference in your life. That's the fourth thought here. We've got to let God give us new purpose and new direction. We've got to get that new purpose. Elijah, Paul, our dream teamers, they've all found a purpose that's greater than their pain. And so before we can see what God has for us, we've got to see that he's working in our life. And so as we close this morning, I want you to think about this. You don't have to go down the drain of discouragement and depression. You can overcome. You can get your life back, and you can live with purpose and direction. You say, Pastor, how do I do that? Well, this is a great day to be here. You can come after second service to Growth Track, and we're going to help you see how God wired you and how that ties into the purpose that he has for your life. It'll change your perspective. It'll help you take that step. Let's bow our heads this morning, and I want to just give you a moment here today just to think about what changes you need to make in your life. And as I pray, would you just let God make that change? Maybe it's an attitude, a heart thing that you've got to work through. Father, in Jesus' name, you know our needs. You know our struggles. You know where we're stuck. And Father, today I ask you to do a work in our lives. Father, I pray for every person struggling with depression, discouragement, anxiety today. Lord, move them forward to the next step with you. Father, help them to trust you. Help them to make the adjustments in their own lives. And help them to get the victory over these things that have plagued and paralyzed them. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. With every head bowed, I don't know if you're in right relationship with Jesus today or not, but you can be. And it's very simple. Simply by praying a prayer, asking him to come into your life, to forgive your sins, just surrendering the leadership or what the Bible calls the lordship of your life to him. And so we're going to pray a prayer. You can pray it with those of us who've already made that decision. But let's pray it together and let's ask Jesus to rule and reign in our lives. Let's say this together. Heavenly Father, I come to you today. I ask you to forgive me of my sins. I ask you to make me a new person from the inside out. God, I turn away from my old life and I turn to you. God, I believe you raised Jesus from the dead. Jesus, I ask you to lead my life. I surrender to you. Thank you for forgiving my sins. I want to live the rest of my days for you. In Jesus' name, amen. Come on, can we celebrate with those that made that decision today?